Welcome to the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network. A mix of today's hits and hard-to-find favorites, combined with the most entertaining and intriguing talk anywhere. This is your sound. This is the sound of Universal Broadcasting Network at UENradio.com.
Oh, yeah. That sounds like Take Six. Huh, I know those guys. Hey, everybody, I'm Claude McKnight, and you're hanging out with Claude McKnight. We're going to have some fun here. This is actually my second show. You know, I guess I'm going to, you know, each week be like, okay, this is my third show. This is my fourth, until I get so comfortable with it that I'm like, hey, everybody, you're hanging out with Claude McKnight. And that's all I end up saying. But yeah, this is Feels Good from Take Six, my group. For those of you who don't know, I started this group, when was it? 1980, I guess, when I was a wee lad. Wee lad, yes, John. John is sitting here with me. John Williams, my good friend, my new friend.
Yes, how was your fourth?
It was good.
Yeah?
I ate way too much, man. Way too much. So I was in the gym the next morning.
Oh, I bet.
Fit at 51. Hashtag fit at 51.
There you go.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. But, you know what? Even before I get into anything else, I have to say this. I play basketball 3-4 times a week.
Mm-hmm.
And that's kind of my cardio. That's what I do.
That's good.
Saturday morning, I get up and I played for 4 hours. 4 hours. I haven't done that since I was like 21 years old.
Wow.
But what happens is when you play basketball that long, you have to have at least that many hours of sleep.
Mm-hmm.
Immediate sleep. I'm not even going to lie. I didn't even take a shower. I just jumped on top of the bed and fell out. But it was good. I had a great time.
Yeah.
And we won all the games. That's how you keep playing.
Yeah.
Now, John, I know you play ball all the time,
oh,
right?
Oh, yeah, right.
John, you're laughing.
No, I don't.
No basketball
no
for you?
No basketball for me.
Do you watch basketball?
Not really.
John, do you watch sports at all?
No.
John, am I talking to the wrong guy here?
You are. Maybe Jamal will be helpful with that conversation.
Man. You know, help me out here, brother.
I know. But we do have two sports shows here. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll have to invite them in.
Yeah, definitely. Have you on with Billy Davis.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. That'll work.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had to get my basketball story out the way. It's funny. At 51, mm-hmm. I think I'm actually a much better ball player than I used to be. Now, this isn't just a sports story. This is a life story, ladies and gentlemen. Because what has happened is, now that I'm not nearly as athletic as I used to be,
mm-hmm.
I have to use my brain a lot more. So what I do is I get there each day and I size up the competition. I look at the guy that I'm playing against and I say, is he bigger than me? Is he younger than me? Is he faster than me? How can I beat this guy? Sometimes it's just an elbow to the throat.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that sometimes that works. Or whatever else I need to do. So anyway, we have a great show planned for you. We have the wonderful and talented Cheryl Bentyne.
Very cool.
Who sings with the incredible, and I believe this is a 10-time Grammy Award winning group, the Manhattan Transfer.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. We got it.
Yes.
She's going to come on in just a little bit. I've got my good friend and publicist who doesn't want to be named or seen. Her name is Melinda Jackson. She's in the studio with us, and
Hi.
She's hanging out. Hey, Melinda.
I'm here, and I love basketball. So.
Oh, there we go. Who's your favorite team?
Carolina Tar Heels.
Oh, we're going college now.
That's the only thing that matters to anybody from North Carolina.
Oh, I hear you.
Unless you're my generation, which was we grew up either on the Hornets or the Bulls because Michael Jordan.
Of course.
Other than that.
Who was a Tar Heel?
Yeah.
Always a Tar Heel?
Yeah, national champion. Hello.
Ah, okay. Tar Heels. So you don't have a favorite NBA team?
I pick whoever has the most Carolina players. So, I will pull for my LA team is the Clippers. I love
the Clippers.
I love Reggie Bullock. He's on the Clippers.
Okay.
He was a Carolina Tar Heel. Also, Blake Griffin, hello. He's a total babe. How can you not like him? Chris Paul went to Wake Forest.
Did you just say a total babe?
He is a total babe.
See, I don't really watch basketball for that. But okay, that's good for you.
But then you have Chris Paul, who's amazing. He didn't go to Carolina, but he's still in the ACC from North Carolina and everything, Wake Forest. So
okay.
Clippers are probably my team.
Do you like any Duke players?
Did you just cuss at me right now? those are fighting words.
Oh man, the audience couldn't see her eyes. Yeah. There was fire. What's that
fire.
About? I understand.
I will not. I will literally, like, I will be talking to a guy and they're like, "Oh yeah, I like Duke." I'm like, "Please just go away from me. Like, this is it's all no."
Even if he's a total babe.
Even if he's a total babe, I've literally been like, "Go away from me right now! Like, get out of my face."
Wow.
It's fighting words. Okay. I'm telling you, anybody from North Carolina.
Okay. Well, those of you who are just joining us, like I said just a little while ago, we have a wonderful show planned for you. Cheryl Bentyne is in the building. She's going to join us in just a little bit. She sings with the Manhattan Transfer. One of my boys from way, way, way back. We go back easily 30 plus years. His name is David Person. Not only a friend, he's a mentor. He's a cat who's been through quite a bit of life experiences, and he and I have shared quite a bit, and I had to have him on my show. He's one of the people who I've trusted with a lot of information over the years. We're not going to get into all of my information. We may unearth some of his, though. I don't know. We'll have to see how the conversation goes. And then later on, we're going to have Sinbad call in. He's on the road. I'm trying to figure out how this Sinbad segment is going to work each week. It may be just, you know, Sinbad checking in from the road, of which I guess I'm going to have to start doing that.
Yeah.
Starting next week, because we leave, we being Take Six, my group that I sing with for, you know, ever. Mm-hmm. We leave for Europe and actually on the 9th, and then we come back on the 3rd of August. So Europe and Japan. So I'm going to be on the top of some mountain somewhere, broadcasting live, or however we're going to do this.
All right.
Skyping from the Alps. I don't know. In the middle of.
Well, we're global, so there you go.
There we go. Yeah. I like it. We're global. We're. Yeah, I was going to say something funny, but I couldn't think of anything. Mm. Nothing was coming up. So in the interim, let me see. We've talked about basketball. Just a couple of minutes. I have to say this. Everybody who follows me on social media knows traffic in L.A. Oh. What in the world?
Especially this weekend, right?
Oh, man. 10 p.m., 11 p.m., the 101, the 405. What is going on? Yeah. You guys have 4, 5, and even 6 lanes sometimes. I'm looking directly into the camera right now. 6 lanes, and there's always a traffic jam. What is going on with that? People hanging out in the left-hand lane, driving slowly? What is up with that? You know, I'm a praying man. I'm a unabashed Christian. I pray every day, but I tell you what, I lose my religion every time I'm on the freeway. Mm. I guess that speaks to what's really going on in my heart. I don't know, but I tell you, I just had to get that off my chest. And I also ride a motorcycle. Please, people, please. Look out for us on our motorcycles. I ride a loud Harley, so I'm telling you, I have no problem with driving up to you and revving my engine, because I really want you to know where I am at all times. On two wheels, I'm not taking any chances. I'm not trying to go fast. I'm not trying to get around you. I just want to live. Let me live, y'all.
Right.
I'm saying that because I know my mom, every time I get on it, she's like, "Oh, baby, be careful." But she says the same thing when I'm in the car, because I do drive a little too fast. But it has nothing to do with you crazy drivers out here who just, I don't know. Okay, I'm done with that. I'm done with that. You know what I think I want to do right now is I think I want to play a song from the Manhattan Transfer, a song that as I was really getting into them, which was right around 78, 79, 80 or so. I think this song came a little later. It's a song called Ray's Rock House. Check it out. I can remember the video and everything.
Race Rock House, that's my junk. House of soul, get my point. We don't care what's your.
Bye. McKnight, there's a speed. That's a part of the fun. This is Todd from Willen of the Joint, in a search for her son. Every Saturday night he sneaks out, leaving her in the lurch. But she's looking to bring him on home, cause tomorrow is church.
She really hates the Rock House.
Yeah.
She's sure the devil is in control here.
Nothing but rock control here.
Yo.
Rock House, ladies and gentlemen, the Manhattan Transfer. Yeah.
There's a lot of people in here.
Yeah. And they always kind of clap the same. Sounds exactly the same.
Yeah, but they're consistent.
There you go. I had to play that song because my guest right now is the wonderful, talented, beautiful, hugely smiling Cheryl Bentyne. Ladies and gentlemen.
Hello, everyone.
Yes.
Hi.
Oh, it's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you. It's
my
fun.
Pleasure.
This is great. It's a whole new world in here.
Whole new world?
Yeah. This whole new form of communication across the airwaves in the vortex of my mind. I love it. I'm loving
cool.
it here.
I'm glad you're here. Just want to talk a little while with you, and then I'm going to ask you to stay for the rest of the show because you're that kind of person.
We'd love to
have you here. Cheryl, I just want to get right into it. You've been singing with this group now for, I guess, what?
34
years.
I'm the new kid.
The new kid. Right. See, I did a little bit of research on the group. even though we've known each other for a long time, and realized that you were, I guess, in the second iteration of the group.
The second incarnation, that's right. In 1979, Laurel Massey, the original soprano, was in a terrible, terrible car accident and went into the hospital and had to have her jaw rebuilt, and it was just, it was awful. And in that time, she kind of made the decision. She just didn't want to do that anymore.
Right, right.
Whatever that was. I still can't define that, because I think part of it was touring, part of it was the style of music that the group wanted to go into, which was more jazz.
Right.
Lucky for me. So. And then I kind of auditioned.
Nice. Yeah, okay. Yeah. And it's been a wonderful ride ever since.
Yes. I mean, we were talking earlier how, you know, 34 years of my life is over, a little over half of my life, you know, in terms of these people, you know, the relationship. It's so, as you know, it's so complicated.
That's what I wanted to get to.
So complicated.
Absolutely.
Right?
I've been in a group, five other guys. Yeah. We like each other. We love each other. But there are times, because we're family,
right,
you get on each other's nerves. Yeah. There are times when you have to make decisions that are unpopular or uncool. How do you guys handle?
I mean, like you said, it's family, but it's business.
Yes.
So there's business decisions. There's business relationship. You have to kind of somehow draw that line. And it's very, very, very.
Now, is there
sometimes
one person who is kind of the leader and whose voice is the last one in the room?
Maybe the loudest voice, but I'm not going to name any names. But at the end of the day, we all have to agree.
Yes,
we all have to. So,
but there are times, I'm sure, when you don't all agree.
Oh yeah,
but you have to move forward.
You have to move forward, and now we have a fifth member who, thank you very much, Mr. Ed Keene, is helping us in that respect. Because when you do have four people.
Yes.
It's that odd number that, okay, two and two.
Now, Ed Keene, for the listeners, Ed Keene is
the manager of Take Six.
And
the manager of the Manhattan Transfer.
Isn't that something? You
Thank
see how
you
things
very
come
much.
Together?
We love
synergy.
Ed Keene. Ed Keene is our best friend.
Isn't he wonderful?
I love him very much.
We call him our angel.
There you go.
Because he's really saving the day for us.
Well, you know, the thing about groups is it's really all about communication.
Yeah.
If you have good communication, you last. If you don't, you will not. Or you may continue, but I don't think that you can realize your potential in the healthiest of ways if you don't learn how to really have that kind of communication.
Yeah, there's one thing I always say when somebody asks, how have you stayed together this long? How do you do it? And my answer is, it's because we know each other so well.
Mm.
We know each other so well to not push certain buttons,
yes,
to keep the peace, to know what the other person a lot of the time is thinking or where
give
they go.
Give people space.
Exactly.
Yes.
Give people space and respect. Respect.
Right. Yeah, that is tantamount
is
for everything. Yeah.
Yeah.
You
is.
Don't even have to like each other at times, but you do have to respect each
Absolutely.
Other.
Absolutely.
Because
Absolutely.
The respect will be the foundation
That's right.
for everything. So
That's right.
in groups, if you have a group out there or thinking about having a group, learn the people who are with you, have respect. And figure it out.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to go to something right. else. You did say that I could ask you anything.
You can ask me anything.
I want to ask you a little bit, and depending on how comfortable you are or whatever, I know you've had some health challenges in the last couple of years. And through those, and we'll talk about the challenges themselves, but you had to come off the road for a little while, which meant someone else was singing in your place.
Before
we get to actually the challenges of your health, I want to know how you felt having someone else singing your parts.
Well, and this is the honest truth.
Okay.
That didn't faze me at all.
Okay.
I just knew they had to keep going. They had bookings. I was off the road for 8 months. So, and it's never happened in that group. In 40 plus, 42, 43 years, it's never happened. And so the woman, I mean, Janice Siegel, she forged ahead in New York and only had a couple weeks to figure this out, because I got sick and had to like immediately go in the hospital, la-di-da-di-da, and she had to find somebody for the Christmas tour, because I got in the hospital. I said, I'm sorry, I have to be out of here in about a week. And they went, no, you're not going anywhere. So in that sense, I just did what I was told, and I was thankful they found somebody. And I didn't feel threatened at all. I just felt, as I didn't have time to go there.
Right.
It was all about just healing my body, and hopefully they would take care of themselves. And
as far as healing your body, tell the listeners what you have been going through.
Oh, well, 3 years ago, in 2011, we were out on a tour, and I started getting the flu, thinking I was just, you know, run down, and it got worse and worse and worse really quickly. And by the end of the tour, Alan, my partner Alan Paul, looked at me and he said, "You are going to my doctor the day you get home. Something's wrong." I had lost about 30 pounds, 30 pounds on this, you know, made me pretty hard to deal with. And I couldn't eat, and I had no strength. I had Hodgkin's lymphoma. Okay. I had cancer. So I went in immediately. Within 1 day when I got home, they had me in the hospital. I had a splenectomy. I was down for the count for the next 8 months. I had 12 rounds of chemo, and just did what I was told. You know, and I know that sounds kind of crazy to say. That was the easy part. Being taken care of was very easy, you know, for me, because you know how we take care of ourselves.
Sure.
So this was really an odd thing for me to just be sitting on the couch at home, and I'd do chemo 1 week and then stay home the next week. So it was kind of a mellow version, if you can imagine, of cancer. I was cancer free after 4 treatments, but I had to do 8 more.
Right.
I had to do the whole thing. I said, please.
And you know, I followed a lot of what you were posting and everything
on
Facebook, and it was very inspirational.
Yeah.
And I know you and I talked about this yesterday.
Yeah.
How you felt, I guess you had hundreds of people write you, and even at some point, you were even wondering if your postings were getting on people's nerves and things of that nature.
Or being like, poor me,
right,
and all that stuff.
Right.
And I didn't do it for that. I kind of just did it because, one thing, I was bored. The other thing, I thought, well, maybe there might be somebody out there that can relate to this, that wonders why I'm off the road for this long, you
right,
know, because
right.
I told my partners, I said, I think we have to say something, because this looks like, you know, I'm in rehab or something, you know, which is, I was
just communication. There you go. Right.
My illness. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So then I went back out on the road for a year, and then almost to the week, 2 years later, it came back, and it came back worse. It came back aggressively non-Hodgkin's, and then I was in the hospital for 3 weeks. This was a shorter stint, but it was much more intense, where they said, you know, where I think we'll do chemo, and then, you know, how old are you? I think a stem cell transplant's a great idea. And I went, sure, whatever that is. I didn't even know.
Right.
Until we went through it, you know, which it's amazing. It was amazing. So I'm 5 months yesterday, I have new stem cells.
All right.
And they call it your new birthday. So
okay.
Now I have 2 birthdays.
Mm-hmm.
Because they put all new blood in you, and like a year from when I got it, I have to get my like 1 year inoculations, like a 1 year old.
Right.
It's crazy.
Brand new.
I'm brand new baby. So everything's good. Everything's
working.
Well,
I tell you, your energy, your spirit, everything is just so beautiful. You know, it's a wonderful thing to have you here and to have you talk about it and to share.
Thank you.
Because my show,
you.
I wanted to have friends of mine and people that I've looked up to, people that could be considered celebrities here and there, but we're all the same people.
Yeah,
we're all going through something.
Yeah.
You know, we all have issues of faith. We have issues of grace, you know, things that we should share with
each other. Those are two of my favorite words. I mean, the whole time I was in the hospital, it never occurred to me that I wouldn't survive.
Hmm.
So right there, I think I had some sort of built-in faith that just kind of said, okay, we'll do this, and then we'll do that, and then I'll be fine. You know, but then you realize the people around you have the fear.
Right.
Because they're one step away, and they can't do anything for you, except clean your house or, you know, get you food or, you know, like my daughter had a much harder time than I did.
Sure.
You know, because she's one step away, and there's fear there. There's a lot of fear because she doesn't know. I'm just walking through it. So there was a lot of faith.
And how are you feeling now?
I feel good. Okay. I feel very good. You know, I'm just kind of getting back on my feet, and I can't believe it was only 5 months ago. Friends of mine are going, Cheryl, sit down. You were in the hospital 5 months ago. I said, I know, but I got a whole new set of cells going on. So they're working.
And it's when do you guys go back out on the road?
We've done a couple of tours here and there this summer. We're kind of revving up again, I think, September-ish.
Okay.
We have a few things here and there right now. Not like you guys. You guys, I mean, what? 300 days a year. You're out.
407. Come on. 300.
Yeah, that is more accurate. Unbelievable. So we're hoping to follow that. Actually, I think we hope to work together at some point.
We're going to. It's not hope. Ladies and gentlemen, you
it's
heard
really
it here first.
Happen.
That's right. Same manager. How could it not?
I know, right? Oh, I'm very excited.
It's going to be very cool. You know what? I wanted to ask you this. I was thinking about this, probably because I ask myself this at times. You know, my group has been together now professionally, I guess, 26 years.
26.
I started this group.
Yeah.
You've been in your group for 34 years. What do you feel, honestly, when you see other groups coming out who, you know, may at this point in their careers have more success than what you may presently be having, or you see things or hear things, you're like, we could be doing that, or we should have gotten that, or whatever. Do you guys ever talk about those kinds of things? Those conversations
come
up?
Sure. You know the answer to that. Absolutely.
I
mean, it's frustrating, but then I have to think, you know, we had our huge time in the when we had pop hits. We actually had pop hits.
Right.
As well as jazz. 1 year we won a Grammy for jazz and pop vocal. Well, that's unheard of now. You know, and music has changed so drastically, and the record business and labels. Are there any labels? I guess there are. You know, it's all changed.
I have a label
so...
in my jacket.
Oh,
hold on. Oh, go ahead.
Ba-da-dum-bum. So, yeah, of course I go through that. But I also think, you know, because we've been around so long and we're not as visible on television. We used to be on Johnny Carson all the time, you know, and that really, when you got that visibility, it's people know you. But the strange part is we still fill concert halls. So there's still, we have our core fans. God love you guys out there because we do still have a huge following.
In other words, you still have a career. You still have a career.
I hope to.
Hope
to shout, yeah.
You absolutely do.
Yeah, we're in the process of starting a new project, so.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's, yeah.
All right.
I hope we have a career.
Yes,
I
you
hope
do.
We still do.
You will always have a career. Yeah. You guys are so great.
Yeah.
It's been my pleasure talking to you.
Thank you, as I said earlier,
I want you to stick around. I believe we have my good buddy, David Person, on the phone. Dave, are you there, my friend?
I am here. What's happening?
What's going on, man?
How you doing?
I'm doing well. Say hello to Cheryl.
Hello.
Cheryl, it is such a pleasure to meet you.
Oh, it's a pleasure to meet you.
I was telling Claude earlier today that I remember when a special blend, the group that Claude used to sing with that I know you're very familiar with.
I have a cassette still of
Special Blend.
Wow,
I need to get that from you.
I got it.
I remember when they sang Smile Again from Mecca for Moderns. And that turned me on to... I knew about Manhattan Transfer, but I had only a casual sort of... I think I was turned on to you guys by Boy from New York City. That was sort of a hit in Chicago where I was growing up.
Yeah, thank you.
But then that turned me on to Smile Again and the rest of that album, which was a great project. So it's a real honor to talk to you as well as to Claude.
Oh, thank you. It's a pleasure.
David, my man, for people who don't know you, I know you very well, and now you've introduced yourself to Cheryl. Just give a few minutes, just a little bit of what it is you do, Dave, and then I'm going to jump on the tail end of that, if you don't mind.
Sure, man. Well, you know, again, it's a pleasure to be here. Some of your Huntsville crew shouts told me to give you a shout-out, Preston Foster, Stephen Foster, Kenny Anderson. You know those cats well. What I do is I'm a media personality here in the South. I do a daily talk radio show, news-oriented talk radio show on WEUP 94.5 FM, 1700 AM. And we also stream at WEUPAM.com. I also am on the board of contributors for USA Today. So I write columns for them a few times a year. Usually I'm tackling social justice kinds of issues. They may involve something related to life here in the South, but many times not. I do documentaries. I direct and produce documentaries. I do media consulting, that sort of, and PR consulting. In fact, I'm doing some major consulting with a nonprofit here called Phoenix that provides jobs and other services for people with disabilities, some media and PR consulting for them. So I do a lot of that sort of thing.
Dave, yeah, you do a lot of that, but you know what you do, man? This is one of the most conversational, think outside the box kind of brothers I've ever known. And I'm not sure I've ever really said this to you. I mean, in some form or fashion, I'm sure in the 30 plus years, we've kind of shared that with each other. But, you know, Dave is, he's certainly my brother. You know, he's in my family. You know, we've been through things. He's been through things. I've been through things. And we've been able to share. And the funny thing about our relationship is we can go a year, two, 3 years without really connecting. And then he'll reach out or I'll reach out or we'll see each other somewhere and just fall into a conversation where, you know, it's like no time has really gone by because you have a foundation that is so similar and that you feel comfortable being vulnerable. And that, interestingly enough, isn't something that men do all that often, especially African-American men.
I agree, man. And I'm going to say to you, I think that you and I definitely share that. But I think we can probably say there are a few more cats that we share that with who have that that common, you know, Oakwood experience and Oakwood University where we attended. You know, just bonds for life, man. And I'm just glad that you know, as you've alluded to, you and I have had, we've walked the same path. I'm not even going to say a similar path, but the same path in some key areas of our lives. And I think God has brought us both to the place where we could be transparent with each other and with other people about that journey. And I think we both are the better for it. I listened to your podcast from last week, your inaugural podcast, and I know that you, you know, as I've said to people through the years about you, I've said, you know, Claude, man, has grown spiritually in some ways that, you know, are really inspiring, and I saw that on the podcast last week, man.
Well, I appreciate that, man. I appreciate that. So this is just a love fest right now. Thanks, Dave. Thanks, Dave, man. You know, part of the reason, I'm going to be honest with you, part of the reason I wanted to have you on this week is kind of twofold. One, when I first was presented with this opportunity, Dave was one of the people that I reached out to say, hey, man, I got this thing coming up, and I need to figure out what I want to do and whatnot. And in his calming way, he was like, well, you know, Claude, you know, this is something that I've always thought that you could probably do. And so in a way, you know, I got to tell you, man, it was just so encouraging to get that from you. But the second part of that is I knew that he was going to listen to or watch the broadcast from last week. And then he gave me these detailed, copious notes. And I wrote them down, Dave, and I'm going to read a little bit of this. This is a friend. Let me tell you what a brother does for you. Hey, bro, watched the show last night. Good first effort. You obviously were nervous, but that's very understandable for a first time. The strongest segment was when you read and answered Facebook posts. Definitely keep that up. And then he goes into a bunch of other stuff, and he was very, very honest. And the funny thing is, pretty much all of the stuff he said I had already kind of beat myself up about. And I needed to hear that because, you know, sometimes it's really cool to get the, man, that was great, that was great, that was great. But you also need those people who are like, hey, look, maybe you shouldn't do this again. Maybe this could be stronger if you did it this way. And so that, you know, the kind of criticism that you respect and is constructive criticism. Yeah. And as soon as he gave it to me, I reached out to him. Hey, Dave, you want to be on the show, man? I was like, hey, man, you got to come on the show. And he was like, man, I'd love to. And the funny thing is, man, I knew even though I kind of sprung it on you at last minute, I knew that you'd find a time to do it. So I really, really appreciate that.
Oh, So, my pleasure.
And then this last paragraph. Okay, bro, hope this helps. Call if you have any questions. Yes, it definitely helps. It you hurt my feelings, man, but
that's how you know somebody's a good friend, though. They're not afraid to give you that criticism.
That's
what everyone needs.
That's right.
And it was you know, I wouldn't even say criticism. I mean, it was just observations in love. You know, I mean, Claude is my boy. I mean, I'm proud of Claude. He is, and not just Claude, but all the guys in the group. But Claude and I have, I think, a bond. We've developed a bond through the years that's unique to us. And I'm real proud of Claude. You know, I remember, and Cheryl, you may appreciate this. Mm-hmm. I remember when I was 16 years old. I went out on a little, I guess I'll call it a date, with a young lady. And the date was that we went to a church in Chicago to see this family that I'd never heard of, the Willis family.
What?
Have their musical reunion. Yes, man. What? I thought I told you this. I never told you this?
I'm not sure. I need to hear this.
So I'm sitting there in the audience with, and I'll tell you, the young lady was Andrea Wright.
Okay.
You remember Andrea?
Yes.
All right. So Andrea and I are sitting there in the audience and at Hyde Park SDA Church in Chicago, south side of Chicago. And these four young cats get up to sing. And I'm just blown away because I'm like, these dudes are like my age. Well, it was Claude and Freddie, my classmate Freddie, and Brian and Mike.
Those are my three brothers.
Oh, my gosh.
And,
yes.
Oh my,
and you all
gosh.
Were so tight at that age.
Oh.
I've always sung, and I've always dabbled in music in various ways, you know, taking violin lessons, piano lessons, the whole nine. So I know music a little bit. But I was like, man, these guys are my age singing like that. I can't sing like that. So, I mean, I have this sort of long view of Claude and his life, the arc of his life. And I'm just so proud of where he is now. So, yeah, man, it was all about, you know, this is all about you just doing your thing, man. That's what it's all about.
So, man, we've known each other longer than I thought then.
Yeah, you didn't know me then, and I didn't. We weren't introduced that day, but yeah, I knew of you from that day forward. So when I rolled down to Oakwood, came down here to the South, and then I see you doing your thing with Merv and Mark and Joya and Lori, and then with the guys, you know, it was like, to me, it was just on the same continuum. You know?
Well, you know, it's funny. Let me share this with you, and I'll share this with everybody here on the panel. You know, I used to sing with my brothers, and I used to sing bass in that group. And Brian was like our
bass?
Little... Oh, yeah.
From bass that's to right. where you are now.
Oh. Yeah, it's kind of hilarious.
Wow. That's right.
But I sang bass in the group, and then I started the Gentlemen's and States Quartet, which is, you know, the predecessor of Take Six. It was four guys, and I wanted to sing bass in that group as well. But no one else could sing the first tenor part.
Uh-oh.
So I was like, well, I can sing first tenor. At that time, I was all into Philip Bailey and Earth, Wind, and Fire and whatnot.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So I could sing all the high stuff, too. But
yeah.
the real part of the story I want to get to is I was always much more comfortable in groups because growing up, I was so shy that I was like, I love
really?
To sing, but I don't want to do this junk by myself.
You're shy.
Oh, man. I'm
interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Just not with a camera guessed. In my face.
Right.
No.
Wow, yeah, okay,
yep.
All right.
So, man, that was just my aside. I took away a little bit of your time there, Dave. But
No, but it leads me to a question. I want to ask you a question.
Okay.
I've always been curious about this. Do you know what your octave range is?
Yeah, what is your
range? You know what's hilarious? Weeks ago, I saw this thing going around Facebook where I guess there was a study, and they said that Axl Rose has the largest range on record as far as recordings and whatnot. It was like five octaves. I was like,
what?
Well, I got five octaves.
Oh my. You have five?
I got five.
I
ouch.
We need to get a piano in here.
Yeah. We do.
You know, I know you
And we need
sing.
To bring Axl up in here.
I know.
That's right.
And I know you can sing higher than me. And that's really.
Get out of here.
Oh, yes.
I can sing lower than you. I know that.
Well, maybe. I don't know. It's, with age, I'm getting lower and lower.
Hey, you know what's funny? So am I.
Yeah. Well, you know what my voice teacher always said? He said, the higher you sing, the lower you'll sing because it stretches the vocal cords out both directions. Very mm-hmm. interesting. Mm-hmm. Very interesting. Yeah. We'll have to have a sing-off.
A sing-off. There we go.
That's
there we go.
That's next time. Okay.
Yeah, but Dave, I'm five octaves. Back in the day, like those first records, when I listen back to that stuff, I'm like, who is this singing? Because there's some of those notes I really can't hit anymore.
I know. I'm not even going to front. It's really sad, isn't it?
It is, especially when we put one of those songs in the show. Uh-oh. And I'm like, oh,
I'm doing
not
that
tonight.
Too. You have to alter it. Hey, we're aging gracefully. What, you know, come
there
on.
You go.
Come on.
There you go. So.
Yeah, I suspected as much because I know that, you know, having heard you through the years, your voice, I know all of our voices lower with age, as you all been talking about. So I kind of wondered if you were still able to hit those real high.
See what's happening here? Again, this brother in love is telling me I can't hit the notes I used to hit. You see what's going on
you
here?
Just
that was
said
slick,
that, though.
Too.
Now, you just said
it,
that.
Me saying it. But see how slick that was? Thanks, Dave. Yeah.
But may I say, you just re-recorded your first record.
We did.
And I'm positive you didn't change any keys.
We
so
didn't.
That's
right.
See? Incredibly impressive.
But you didn't see me in the studio.
I am impressed. I don't care.
Oh,
you did it.
We did it.
Oh, my gosh.
We did it.
Wow.
That's so impressive. That's unbelievable.
So does this mean that you can sing in Guns N' Roses, though, if you have that same Axl Rose range?
Yeah, that was the next announcement I was going to make.
Okay, cool. Perfect. Yeah. Sorry I ruined it for everyone. Yeah.
Thanks a lot there, Melinda Jackson.
Sorry, you know the publicist knows everything first. Sorry, y'all.
That's funny.
Calling me out, full name and everything.
That's right. You're a star. Well, Dave, my man, thank you so, so, so much, man. I have to have you come back on and after my 100th show, and you can tell me what's right with it.
Oh, I'm sure everything will be right with it, man.
You know I'm just messing with you, man.
Yeah.
Completely messing with you. Tell all the fellas, Kenny and Preston and everybody else, man, I said what's up. You know I follow them religiously online. Mm-hmm. I love all the stuff that's being posted. Tell Preston that, you know, his whole thing with the Spurs and LeBron and all of that, he's on point. Did Preston actually play ball?
You know, I don't know. I don't know if he did or not. I don't, you know, because I've never seen him play ball, so I don't know.
So he might be kind of like Popovich, just a really great coach, huh? Okay.
I'll tell him you said that.
Yes, right, man. He's on it.
I was going to say, Claude said your ball skills might be kind of questionable.
Lacking. But your commentary is great.
Yeah, that's what I'm telling him.
There we go. All right, man. Peace out. I love you, man. And we will
love
talk
too,
very, very soon.
Awesome. Take care.
Ladies
Cheryl,
and gentlemen.
Nice to meet you.
Yeah, nice to meet you, Dave. Bye.
David All right. Person. All right. You know what? In the meantime, let's see what we have here. I've got some more questions. Last week, I told people to ask me questions on my Facebook page, and I had this overwhelming response, and I really couldn't get to all of them. So I threw all of those away and asked people to ask more questions. So let's see what we have here. We have from Osman, my man Osman, Sharif Kui. Here's a question on a topic that might catch you off guard. You seem to be an eat-out kind of guy, which implies you don't cook much. It doesn't mean you don't. It only implies you don't. Here's the question. With your cooking skills in mind, what is the one meal you would put together to impress that special lady? Okay. Let's see. To impress that special lady, probably oatmeal. That's about all I can make. I mean, what? That's all I can do.
It's comfort food. It's
That's
total
right.
comfort food.
That's right.
There you go.
And that would mean that it's good workout food. You know, I eat
it
that
is.
Before I work out,
you
which means she might be athletic.
There you go.
There we go. You know what I can make, though? I can make French toast. That's right.
Ooh.
That's good.
Any time of day or night.
It's not that hard.
What? Come on, Melinda.
It's definitely harder than oatmeal, though. But you have a breakfast theme going. You need to go to dinner.
Move into lunches and dinners.
I know.
Perhaps.
You can't eat breakfast for lunch for dinner?
I don't know about for lunch, but it's definitely for dinner.
Yeah, breakfast is great for dinner.
Well, anybody else who knows me knows that I am a Cracker Barrel aficionado.
Yes.
Every time I stop in one, I think of you.
That's
now.
Right.
You know, sit out in the rocking
and
chair.
And I eat breakfast morning, noon, and night there.
Talking about French toast, y'all. They use, oh my God, theirs is the best. Help. So good.
Yeah.
I'm glad I don't live in the South anymore.
Right.
So fat.
All right. We have another question from Linda Bucci. You're clearly an accomplished artist and performer. Clearly. Yes, clearly, Linda.
Stress that.
Yet, have you ever experienced stage fright? If so, how do you overcome it? Yes. I have experienced stage fright quite a few times. Quite a few times. Earlier, I was talking about the fact that I grew up really, really painfully shy, which is why I sang in a group. The other thing is because I sing falsetto 99% of the time, depending on how I'm feeling, you know, I might not have that special extra note that night. And so I've found that there have been times, especially earlier in my career, mm-hmm. where I would fret on a song coming up. Ooh. Fret, and here comes this song, here comes that song. But what I've learned to do is almost go outside of myself mm-hmm. And just saying, you know what, this is a performance. Almost like an acting thing.
Oh, of course.
You know, because really I know I've got the notes.
Yeah.
You know, and when you can settle yourself and relax, everything just flows. And another thing that really was cool that happened years ago, Mark Kibble, who sings in the group, said something really simple to me. He was like, you know what? Everybody messes up. It's just part of what happens. Yeah. Don't be so concerned about, am I going to hit this note tonight? Am I going to mess up? Because you've got it. Just do what you're going to do.
And you know, in a live performance, guess what? The note is gone out into space. By the time you get to the end of the song and you're fretting over that note that happened earlier,
that's right.
It's gone.
It's gone.
They're only going to remember the last
that's
chord.
That's how they know it's live.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
Now, unless, you know, I really suck, which I'd like to think I don't, you know. Hopefully I'm not going to be, you know, one of those people that they pull up on YouTube. Listen to this guy. You know.
What do they call it when they thrash? Or no, what is it? When they thrash the vocals apart, or the, what is that called?
Oh, that's my favorite. And they completely screw it up to the video. It's so good. And you're like, there's
Let's
no
way.
Let's
hope they don't do it to you or me. Oh, my God.
Never, never. No. Don't listen to what she said.
No.
Anyone. This one is from Bridget Johnson. What new artists that have come out within the last 5 to 10 years do you enjoy most? And what do you think about the writing, lyrical content of today's music? Ooh, that's like a politically incorrect question. let's see. What new artists? For me, tell you who I love right now is Dirty Loops.
Dirty Loops. Aren't they
These
amazing?
Cats, incredibly energetic and musical.
You got to explain what they do people haven't.
Man, what do they do?
Well, they do covers.
They do
Britney Spears. They do Justin Bieber. Mm-hmm. But like you've never heard
them. Heard them before. And it's only, three guys?
I know.
Three guys. And it's so musical. And from what I understand, and I know this, I have this on good record, at least the lead singer grew up listening to my brother Brian and other people like that. I think they're from, where are they
like
from?
Sweden
or some Scandinavian.
I think they're Sweden.
And they are so incredible. So I love Dirty Loops. I think David Foster is working with them.
Yep, of course he is. He grabbed them up.
Yeah. I'm a big Bruno Mars fan.
Too. I knew you were going to say, I had a
Bruno
feeling.
Bruno Mars,
He's fantastic.
Yeah. I think that he's one of those artists who will have a career 20 years from now, 30 years from now, because he's just that talented. He's a showman. He's a writer. He's a great singer. You know, and those are the things I love to hear and to see. I don't listen to a lot of new stuff. I need to listen to more. You know, I have two daughters and they kid me all the time about that. You know, I have a 26-year-old who thinks I'm, so hip anymore.
Okay. Just an aside, my daughter's 19. She goes, Mom, you're going to love this. She goes, don't listen to the words closely, but listen, Busta Rhymes. Oh my gosh.
Because he's so fast.
He's so fast.
I think they literally said he's the fastest rapper.
He's the fastest rapper, which kind of is a vocalese thing of the present day.
Yeah.
I mean, I wonder if he's ever listened to John Hendricks do Cloudburst, right?
I need to have him on the show. Let's ask that question.
Do it.
Come on, Busta. Come on.
I love Busta Rhymes.
Hanging out with Claude McKnight. All right. Got a question here from Eric Darren Hughes Sr. When Mervyn left, even though you were all tight, how did it really affect the group and your feelings toward Mervyn before Joey was brought in? That's a great question, my friend. It was really hard, especially when Mervyn first told us he was leaving, because he was one of the original members. Mm-hmm. You know, for the most part, it was me, Mark, and Merv, and then we had a lot of different changes over the years, but the nucleus was the three of us. So when Merv decided to leave, it was like one of the three amigos is leaving. Oh, you know, this is kind of crazy. But the transition was smooth, and Joey Kibble being Mark Kibble's younger brother, you know, he grew up in the house listening to all of this stuff. So it wasn't like we brought in some cat who didn't understand what we were doing, you know. So it was great. And over the years, our relationship with Merv has kind of, you know, come and gone because he's been so busy doing what he does. He does a lot of music, movie soundtracks things of that nature. And really cool thing, about a month and a half ago, we were inducted into the Gospel Music Association Hall of Fame.
Superstar!
Yes. And what we decided to do was to have Mervyn and Cedric Dent come and join us. And I tell you what, it was the most surreal, incredible experience ever.
Did you guys levitate? I'm sure you did.
Absolutely. Oh, absolutely. But the really cool part was not only did we sing together during the show, it was the rehearsal, just sitting in the dressing room where nobody was there, just hanging out, you know, going through old songs and stories. And it was brothers, you know, just doing their thing. So it's like everything was forgotten. It was just hang out and do this thing.
Wonderful.
So that was really, really great. So, yes. Answer to that question. What else do we
have?
And
the video's online, too. I'm 99% sure it's online if you guys want to go and check it out. It's
I think
super
you're right.
good.
Super good?
It is super good.
You're so young. Super good.
It's super, super good.
That's right. There you go. You got it.
Cool. We're waiting on Sinbad to call in. I think he's in Vancouver.
Canucks.
Yeah. So we're not sure when he's going to jump on the line. But until he does, let's see what we have here. From Tamara M. Lawrence. Her question is in relation to my career. Where do you see yourself in 10 years? What other things would you like to accomplish? Well, I'd like for this radio show to blow up so much that I own the station. I love doing new things. And it's funny because I've always wanted to do new things, but I've had to force myself to do them. Like even this radio show, I mentioned this last week. It was presented to me, and literally 3 weeks later, I had my first show. But I had to do it that way because I know me. I'm a procrastinator. And things that I don't really know how to do yet, I'll just keep talking about them.
Oh,
and next thing
I
you know,
too.
I'll be answering her question 10 years later. I have my first show. You know,
I think that's the mentality of an artist, though. There's a spontaneity that happens. There's, you know, an immediacy. I have trouble planning ahead.
Yes.
In great distance. I have to have a goal.
Okay,
in 2 weeks, I have to do that by then. You know, I'm like you. I'm definitely like you.
I feel you. Yeah. You know what? I think we might have Sinbad on the line.
I think so.
Are you there, my friend? I think someone said, I think so. Is Mr. Sinbad there? He should be here?
Maybe not.
Maybe not.
It's showing that somebody is on the line.
Someone's on the line? Did someone knock him over the head once he called in and they have his phone? If they do, don't look into his pictures because he might have stuff that he doesn't want people to see.
Sinbad, are you there?
Are you there? In the meantime, unless he just starts talking, you know what I was going to also say back to you, my friend Cheryl. Oh, you know what? Actually, let's interview Melinda for a second.
Okay.
Let's go.
Who do you listen to? How old are you, Melinda?
I am 27 years old.
27.
Okay.
Who do you listen to?
Oh my gosh, I have such a crazy musical taste. I know everyone says that, but you know, I grew up in North Carolina. My mom listened to country. My dad listened to like James Taylor and Fleetwood Mac, and so I'm obsessed with all that. And then, you know, I did grow up in the church, and my mom was in a Southern Gospel group. So, you know, that was my life growing up, every Sunday night going to a different church with my mama, listening to her sing.
With my mama. Okay.
Fabulous. So, and then as I grew up, I started singing in the church and doing the same thing. So it's just all very, it's all over the place. But I'm obsessed with Johnny Cash. I love Johnny Cash. And I think he has such a cool story. Mm-hmm. I just finished reading a book about, it's called Johnny Cash, The Life, by this great author. And it's like, holds nothing back. It tells everything. And he just has such a great testimony. And I love that. How, you know, he was super rock and roll, but then he was also, you know, the whole time he was like, oh, I feel so bad about it. Like, he had such conviction. And then, you know, he come to terms with everything later on in his life. So I love Johnny Cash. I love this band, the Foo Fighters. Dave Grohl is like a god among men. He's so brilliant. I really love this band, The Lone Bellow. I just found out The Lone Bellow.
Okay.
They're out of Brooklyn. And they're super like folksy, but I just discovered them randomly on Spotify, and they're so good. They have this song, what is it called? It's called You Never Need Nobody, and it's so, it's just like,
can you sing it for us?
You never need nobody. I don't remember how it goes, but that's all it is.
Lena, she sang for us. I didn't think she was gonna do it.
No, I can't. Okay. I don't know. Whatever.
I like that.
I did too.
But no, I just love that. Wow. And like, me and Claude were talking about this in my office the other day, how vinyls are coming back. And
I know, right?
I stole like all these vinyls from my mom, and I go to Amoeba down the street, and I love like Bob Dylan on vinyl and Fleetwood Mac on vinyl, because that's how it's supposed to be listened to.
Absolutely.
What I listen to, y'all. I listen to everything, but I also really love rap too. So
Do you?
Who's your favorite rapper?
J. Cole. He's a North Carolina boy. He's from Fayetteville, grew up about 20 minutes from me. I love him, and I love Drake. So they're my rappers.
Okay.
And
yeah, right.
You don't want me to rap, because I will do it and it will not be appropriate.
Yeah, I have to be careful. Yeah, it seems
you
like
you have to be so careful.
Yeah, because you came in here today, you were all, you know, quiet and everything.
I
next
just
thing
put
you
her
know,
on
you
camera
just
too.
She's
now on camera.
I don't care, y'all.
Wave to the camera.
Hey.
Now you have to come
sorry
back.
I screwed up your phone or your song, Lone Bellow. I hope you're not watching.
But you just gave them an international shout out.
Go listen to them. They're amazing.
I'm going to
check them out.
Really good. The Lone Bellow. You guys would love them. They have
the
really,
Lone Bellow.
The Lone Bellow.
Okay, because I can't tell what your accent. If you're the long or
no,
the lone.
Lone. Lone, like
the
singular.
Lone. I got you.
Bellow. B-E-L-L.
Bellow. Okay.
Just Bellow. Yeah. However you spell Bellow.
Okay.
However you spell it.
I have a journalism degree. Don't know how to spell.
Hey, you know what's funny about that? You go online now with these social media things, no one can spell.
Literally no one.
Guess what else
grammar.
Nobody does anymore? Nobody writes.
Oh,
no.
They took cursive writing out of schools.
No. Are you serious?
They're taking it out of the schools.
I barely remember how to write cursive. I'm left-handed anyway, so my writing is just the worst. I look like a doctor, but half my letters are cursive, half of them are print. I don't remember how to write in cursive. I just realized that you don't necessarily have to. You don't have to write in cursive on checks. I didn't know that.
Oh, you don't?
Apparently not.
Can you
but
just
you
bring
have to
like
write
a
your
you
know,
have to
signature.
Sign your name, but
yes, yeah, oh. You have to do a signature of sorts.
So, fun anyway. Fact. Sorry, okay. No one cares about me no more.
Yeah, we do.
Care about you no more. Is that what you said?
No mo.
Okay. Well, it looks like we're about to wrap up, ladies and gentlemen. This is a fun-filled hour, and it went by quickly.
And I learned so much.
I learned so much as well.
About
so
you.
So much.
About
I learned a lot about
friend,
you.
Will.
All right. You know, we're going to finish this out. I've got a song that I wanted to have played. This is this is some earth, wind, and fire. This is the long version of Brazilian Rhyme. And I wasn't even familiar with this. Oh, man, this is so nice. We want to thank Cheryl Bentyne.
Thank you, dear Claude. Thank
you. Oh, man.
Best of luck. You're going to go places, buddy.
Thank you so
you're
much.
Going places.
And you're coming back here with the rest of the group, and you guys are going to sing.
Sure.
Okay.
You got it.
All right. Also, David Person, my boy, thank you so much for being here. We're going to have to get Sinbad on the next one. You have been hanging out with Claude McKnight. All right.